It's my second time trying to speak at this meeting because Teresa very kindly invited me last year. And I got all the way as far as the airport, and then I got a phone call from my wife to say, come home, bad news. It's news we'd been through before, to be honest with you. 5 years ago, my five-year-old, as he was then, was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, which is, you know, I'm sure there are type 1 diabetics here in the room. And then my now five-year-old, 5 years on from the first guy, just been diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, so I had to turn around and go home. And it was not nearly as troublesome as it was the first time around, with this incredible life-changing event for our family. But from a technology point of view, and I am a technophile like Brian, I must say that technology is making a big difference for kids with diabetes and grown-ups as well. I'll just share you one example of that. There's a little sensor device now that kids use and grown-ups as well, so you don't have to finger prick anymore. You put a little sensor on your arm, and then you just scan it. So now my five-year-old scans himself and takes his jelly beans or whatever. So no more finger pricks. And those of you who are 40 or 50 years into diabetes, you know your fingers take a big hammering, which can affect career choices as well. So I must say, as a technophile, I think we need to embrace every aspect of innovation to improve the lives of our patients. And not everything will succeed, not everything will add value, not everything will improve quality of life. But little things like not doing finger pricks for the next 70 or 80 years is actually a big deal, a big deal. So I welcome this forum. I think you have an incredibly talented bunch of people in your organization, and this is a great forum. So my task today is to talk a little bit about robotic surgery. I'm the sort of light entertainment at the end of the day before a beer. And my background is I'm Irish, to be sure, and I grew up in the west of Ireland. I did my surgical training in Dublin, and then I trained as a urologist. I'm a urologist in London at Guy's Hospital, Guy's and St. Thomas's Hospital. And I came to Melbourne to do a fellowship 10 years ago, had a fantastic time, went back to London, the GFC hit. Suddenly, life as a young couple, as we kind of were at the time, with a tiny baby, turned from being fun in London to total misery. And the faraway grass was greener. And interestingly, this was the main attraction for me, Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre, which is in the centre part of this picture here. This is the heart of the Melbourne Biochemical Precinct, as we call it, with the University of Melbourne, Royal Melbourne, etc., all there. Had announced in 2009, when the GFC was peaking in London, that they were investing in a $1 billion cancer center, and they needed somebody with my interests to come back and run it. And that is our new cancer center. We opened exactly 1 year ago this week. It's a beautiful building, actually, wonderful place to work, but a wonderful place to be a patient and a wonderful place to do research. It's designed as a comprehensive cancer center, so we have a huge clinical facility, and then we have a huge research facility, and it's all in the one building, which is a rarity nowadays. We're used to working in separate buildings, but this is all in the one very large, very beautiful building, and I encourage you to come and visit us. So here's the, I suppose, the whole forum has set up this question, and it's been quite provocative during the debate as well, hasn't it? Will a robot take your job? So I'm sure there are people in the audience who are blissfully unaware that this might happen. There are some of you in the audience who probably think, yeah, this is a reality, or maybe you're already seeing it. And Melissa spoke about this earlier when she did her mock interview, and I think let's just explore that for a minute, because the machines are coming, the machines are here. And it's not just these types of Terminator 3 type of robots, like the robot I'll speak to you about in a few moments. It's the machine learning machines, these very disruptive technologies, these super smart things that can absorb information, process it, maybe even make a diagnosis much better than any of us here in the audience can do. So the machines are coming, and how we're going to embrace it is really what the debate, disappointingly, with a disappointing result from my point of view, explored earlier on. Come on, gee, next year it'll be different. And this is the apocalyptic scenario that I think the winners were portraying here. And it's been explored, of course. You know, there's a lot about this in pop culture. There's a lot about it in economics. There's a lot about it in health, actually, as well. But we have been here before. This whole thing about robots and technology and disruption has been here before. And if you go back, right back to 1921, you'll see this is a sausage machine devouring the butcher here. And that's going to be the end of people who, you know, prepare meat and cook meat. New York Times again, 1928, March of the Machine Makes Idle Hands. So the Industrial Revolution getting challenged. challenged. Even Einstein in the 1930s was getting concerned about the machine evolution, what's going to happen to human innovation. 1939, on the eve of war, Henry Ford actually felt obliged to write an opinion piece in the New York Times, pushing back a bit, saying, oh, come on, we need technology, we need automation, and we need better processes for industry. But still, the headlines come. 1940, will machines get rid of men in the long run? We see unrest in the UK. That's a familiar theme. Robot revolution, depriving everybody of jobs, and even the UK Prime Minister at the time getting concerned about this. 1961, automation is looming large. Jobless rates are rising as technology comes in, etc., etc. So we've been there before. These things we'll explore in the next few moments are not new. And I suppose that's the question here. Two questions I'll put to you is, one, yes, it could be you, it could be me. Do we feel threatened by automation, by robots, by machine learning, etc.? But the second could be you is like my story I told you about, you know, having sudden health issues in your family and how we deal with that as a family and what indeed technology and healthcare can offer to us to improve quality of life. So I ask you to think of yourselves not just as healthcare employees, as most of you are, but as patients or potential patients, because I think about that quite a bit. So this is my friend Jonathan Hiller yesterday morning. He's my anaesthetist and one of my really good friends. He works with me at Peter Mac and also in private practice as well. And he had a big healthcare scare when his baby was born a year and a bit ago, actually. And it was all down to monitoring. I was feeling very emotional during Sarah's talk, I have to say, because I was living this when Jonathan was telling me what was happening to Zoe and Amy. But they got there, but I suspect they would have got there with less trauma had they got Ollie, to be frank with you. I was stunned with that piece of technology. Congratulations. So we work together, surgeon and anaesthetist. It's a 150-year-old combination, isn't it? And I even married an anaesthetist. You know, that's how well that combination works. I was a urology registrar. Those of you who work in operating theatres will know what this is about. Learning how to do TURP, you know, rebore. There's a few men who've probably had a rebore. I'm not looking at you. So I'm down there between the legs doing a TURP, kind of looking here like this. And Lisa's at the top end, the young anaesthetic trainee. Seems to be bending over all the time, adjusting the ECG dots, and I'm getting an eyeful frequently. Accidentally, apparently, but anyway, the rest is history. So here's my other buddy, Jonathan. So we work very closely together. He puts the patients to sleep, I do the surgery, he wakes the patients up. But I said to Jonathan, I said, I think this might be our future together as a surgeon and anaesthetist couple. So I'll be there on the console or the computer poolside saying, operation's over, Jonathan, I'm closing up now. Give him a little nudge like that, say, can you go and wake the patient up? So I think we envisage an environment where technology might even make us remote from what's happening. And I'll come back to that in a second when we talk about the robots. This is this week, actually. This is there's been a lot of stuff about this week because a website has just been launched called www.willarobottakeyourjob.com. And you can type in your job and see, will a robot take your job? Based on data from Oxford University, very, very big study. So I've got a few categories here. Are there any personal trainers in the audience? Yes, there's a hand, I can see one, nervously, yes. Probably more there. Oh, you're just waving, scratching, yeah. So, will a robot take your job? If you type it into this website, what's the answer? Actually, you're totally safe. And 8.5% of personal trainers in the future will be challenged by robots. So that's actually quite a bit when I thought about it, but the conclusion on the bottom of the thing is totally safe. What about a journalist? Will we still need them in the future, Julie? Well, the answer is no worries. 11% of journalistic type roles will be taken by machines, and that's literally trying to interpret data and make a story out of it. They can actually do that already, so they're creeping in everywhere. What about construction workers? Ooh. 71% of jobs in the construction industry will be taken by robots. And already a lot of them are, aren't they? You know, big trucks are being driven by robots on the mines and all sorts of stuff. So automation's there, and it's going to get even more so. What about bank tellers? When was the last time any of you have been in the bank? You are doomed. So tell your kids, no, don't do that job. What about nurses? How many nurses in the audience? Yeah, a lot of nurses in the audience. If you type it into this search engine, actually great, totally safe. And it's the same for most front-end staff, with a few exceptions. There are some jobs that are at high risk, and you can read lots about this, but I'll just highlight a couple of them. Technicians, technical staff, call service staff are one group, and then radiologists and pathologists are a particular group. This is one of the robots that Device Technologies, one of your sponsors, Teresa, have. It's a pharmacy robot. We've got some of these at Peter Mac, and it dispenses medication. So already, pharmacy technicians, that job is doomed as well, because this type of robot is in probably in some of your hospitals already. And we use this for moving surgical instruments from our surgical sterile services department, which is over at the Royal Melbourne, which we're attached to, across the bridges into Peter Mac. So these two tugs, they've got faces painted on the front of them, move around the place delivering instruments. They go into the lift on their own, they go up the lift, they come out. One was found in the emergency department recently, and then it sent off a message saying, come and get me, I'm in the emergency department. But these are already replacing lots of tasks. Okay, they work 24 hours a day, they deliver stuff back and forth. And we have a little incline going up the bridge from Royal Melbourne to Peter Mac. So carrying all the heavy surgical trays, etc., this is a much safer solution. But if you were the tech who used to do that, well, your job doesn't exist anymore already. So Melissa needs to think about that, you know, when we're mocking some of the jobs. Some of the jobs are already gone, actually, as it turns out. But this is the other really big threat. They're devices, and I'm going to speak about devices in a moment, but machine learning is probably, in my view, the biggest threat to some of the higher-end jobs in healthcare industries. So you probably know a lot about what this is, but I'm going to give you an example. So for example, here's a prostate MRI showing an abnormal lesion here in the prostate. And nowadays, this is a complex scan, but it's very commonly done. But one of our big challenges is inter-observer variability. So when you show this to one radiologist, he'll report it as a blah, 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 because these are really complex scans, multiple sequences. When you show it to another radiologist, about 60% of the time, there's a different answer. If you go back a month later and show it to the first radiologist, there's a 50% chance he or she will give a different answer to the first time they gave it. So this type of inter-observer variability is very challenging. And here's what the machine learning environments do, because machines like IBM, Watson, and there are a few of them out there, like big technology companies are investing billions in this area because there's so much potential market, will go and recognize all these patterns. It's all about pattern recognition. Learn what they mean with the help of a human, and then process tens of millions of these scans in a few minutes to improve their knowledge. And within a few days, they can figure this out, and there will be no inter-observer variability. There'll be some human oversight, but they can process all these scans very quickly, no sick leave, no resting, no, and et cetera, et cetera. And this is an example of getting it right, you know, so this is what they predicted the final pathology would look like on the prostatectomy, and then on the right, is the final prostatectomy exactly right? And we have a PhD student, we've just published the first series of papers in our experience using machine learning. So radiology, I wouldn't tell my kids to do that one, unless they're an interventional radiologist. We still need people to stick tubes in, but this type of pattern recognition-based knowledge will go. And the other one that will be affected greatly by this is pathology. And it's a key part of the diagnostic algorithm for us in a cancer center is the role of pathologists, specialist pathology, molecular pathology, etc. But it is mostly pattern recognition, so it is vulnerable to these types of machine learning technologies. So should we resist them, as the successful debating team suggested earlier, or should we embrace them and think, well, how do we deploy the human factor better? How do we do this to improve everything for our patients? We've got to do the latter. We've got to take it on because this technology will help. There's another example. There's millions of these examples out there. In green, we have what the radiologist says was a pulmonary embolus, and in red is what the machine said, exactly right, in seconds, 24 hours a day, right. And this technology is here, and we need to embrace it and not be afraid of it. So on to the surgical robots, and let's think about the term robot. So this is when the term robot was first coined, actually. It was a Czechoslovakian playwright who wrote this play called Rossum's Universal Robots. And the word robot in Czechoslovakian means forced work. And interestingly, back to where we are now with the rise of the machines, the theme was these robots were helping to do manual labor, and then they took over the world, of course, which is what everybody likes to think is going to happen with these machines. But even before the term robot was coined 100-odd years ago, of course, Leonardo da Vinci, great genius that he was the first person who came up with the vision of what a robot might be. He just didn't have the word robot in his lexicon. What he had was, of course, the Vitruvian Man, his very famous sketch of what the perfect human would look like. And then subsequent to that, because he had an incredible engineering brain as well, He designed this thing here, which he called his mechanical robot, mechanical knight, rather. And it was to be a mechanized version of the Vitruvian Man. And lots of Da Vinci aficionados around the world have recreated his vision for what a mechanical knight might look like. And it's as a result of that, of course, that his name has been hijacked for commercial reasons, because Da Vinci is the term we use when we're describing the commercial robot that we use most of all nowadays. And the origins of this robot that we currently use, and when you hear the term robotic surgery, it's nearly always this that we're referring to, is based on the idea of tele-remote surgery. So it was a grant from Stanford Research Institute, supported by the Department of Defense, where it was thought, okay, we have a battlefield scenario. We have US troops out in far-flung regions of the world. We know that one of the most important things on the battlefield is to get excellent medical attention to those troops very quickly, but it's a hostile place. We don't want our thoracic surgeons being out there in the front end of the battlefield. So can we design an intervention, a robot cart, that will be out on the front end, but the surgeons may be in a central bunker, if you like? And so that concept and that grant is what led to telepresence or teleremote surgery. Of course, in reality, we don't quite do it like that. We are in the same building, in the same operating room, but the idea was based on teleremote surgery and a grant from the US Department of Defense. And this is the commercial system that many of you have seen in your own hospitals. RPA is a huge leader in this field now in Australia. And Da Vinci, as I said, has been hijacked by this US company, Intuitive Surgical, to create what really is a very, very nice surgical system. It's been around really for many years, almost 20 years, and it's evolved into more slick versions. This is a very recent version of it. And just to explain the concept a bit, it's not an automated robot that you press a button and say, take out gallbladder. It's a master-slave device, so the surgeon is still sitting in the corner over here. The cart in the center is docked in a minimally invasive fashion into the patient, and then there's a vision cart by the patient's side. We know minimally invasive surgery, if we can do it safely, is better for patients. You all know that, any of you who've had minimally invasive surgery, less pain, go home the next day, less blood loss, back to work. The problem is the instruments we use for minimally invasive surgery are pretty primitive. It's no problem taking a gallbladder out or doing basic colorectal or gynecological surgery, but complex stuff deep in the pelvis, prostatectomy being an example, or anterior resection, is difficult to do with conventional instruments. So the wristed instruments that you see there are a huge advance over the straight stick chopsticks we use for gallbladder surgery. And these little controls you see here in your hands are very intuitive, hence the company's name. We can twist our wrist out in the console and inside, deep in the body, with an 8mm instrument the size of my finger, we get the same wristedness. And you'll see that here in, for example, suturing. It's a very smooth motion, much smoother than we get even with open surgery, to be honest, but certainly with laparoscopic surgery. So these innovations, wristed instruments, miniaturization, 3D visualization, because it's fully 3D, means that we can take minimally invasive surgery from just relatively straightforward procedures into more complex procedures, but requires this expensive interface to do so. And here's how it's evolved over the years. I say it's been around for a long time, 1999, and I started on this in 2002. I was a registrar in London when this technology came in, so I've seen it all come through. Up to the most recent system, which you have here at RPA, the Da Vinci Xi, same sort of a concept, surgeon is sitting on a console, a surgical cart by the patient's side with four arms and a vision system that controls it on at all. But it has a lot of additional capabilities compared to the early days as these technologies have developed. For example, we can now have two consoles instead of one, and this is fantastic for training, as I'll explain in a moment. And this is what you have at RPA as well. This is sort of Rolls Royce in a teaching center, to have the main surgeon on one console, trainee on the other console. You can hit a button and swap the controls back and forth, like learning how to drive, if you like. So fantastic for training. Also, fluorescence-guided surgery. So we can inject radioactive tracers or dyes into patients and then watch as the fluorescent dye goes to, for example, the positive lymph nodes in a gynecological cancer, as you'll see here. And then we can go and dissect out those positive nodes. So this type of technology allows you to bring in other technologies into the surgical field in a way we can't do with open surgery. And there are the lymph nodes we can see here. As we hit a button on the console, we'll flick back and forth and turn the fluorescence on and off so we can accurately localize where the tumor is. Also, we've just bought this on our newest machine at Peter Mac, the new Xi. You can integrate the table into the machine as well. And this was one of the disadvantages of the surgery initially was The patient would be literally bolted into the robot. So sometimes we like to adjust the position, to move the bowel, to move something in the chest, but you can't do that if the robot is docked. So this new integrated table means we can safely move the patient. For example, if they're having bowel cancer surgery, we'll start with the patient in this position, and then we'll put them in that position to finish off the surgery. So lots of technologies coming along. And I'll speak about training in a moment, but this is one of the capabilities that demonstrates that. And I'll speak about RPA's role in this as well. So here's one of our dual console systems in Melbourne, and there's one of my trainees. He's actually participating in a European fellowship program. And part of that is he has to sit on our simulator, which is part of the robot, and go through a series of tasks which are scored by the machine. And then he's continuously trying to better his previous performance. And we insist that our trainees spend hours and hours acquiring skills in these simulators, which we can't do with open surgery, before we will let them do human-level surgery. So why even do this? Is it just boys with toys, etc.? You know, why do robotics? Should we not just pop the hood and have a look inside? And I still do pop the hood and have a look inside. And almost every Thursday at Peter Mac, I will do a total pelvic exenteration with my colorectal colleagues, because sometimes you just have to pop the hood. But there's no doubt about it, this type of technology has broadened the scope of minimally invasive surgery for sure. Our challenge, as I'll speak about, has been proving that that's the case. But here's an example. Here's a patient of mine, a 74-year-old, Frank is his name, and that's his goddaughter, Lily, a 2-year-old. Now, Frank, when he came to see me, had been turned down open surgery by his original urologist because he'd had a hernia repair and an infection. He said it'll be too difficult, you need to go for radiotherapy. But he lived 150 kilometers from his nearest radiotherapy center, which is a whole other issue, the way in which we can get that type of technology more accessible to patients. And he didn't want to do that because he looks after Lily every day while both the parents work. And then he heard that, oh, he could come into us and have an opinion about robot surgery. And we said, yeah, sure, we'll take your prostate out. That's no problem. And here he is the day after his surgery. You can see on his hand, he's got the little dressing from the IV cannula. So the day after surgery, he's at home with Lily, as usual, looking after her. Only missed her for one day. Now, any of you who have had open pelvic surgery know that this is an unimaginable scene if you've had an open radical prostatectomy or cystectomy or anything like that. But we get 92% of our patients home the next day, and that's what they look like. And the reason is we turn that into this, and that's the great enabler. And it's also the opportunity from a value point of view, turning a 4.8-day hospital stay we have in the public system in Australia into a 1.3-day hospital stay with the associated savings, et cetera, et cetera. And what about other specialties? I'm a urologist, but we do a lot of kidney surgery, colorectal surgery, chest surgery, and most recently, transoral robotic surgery. So we put the robot in the mouth of the patient. That's the patient's mouth there on the right with the robot docked in the back. So instead of making an incision here to open up the mandible and take out the tonsil, you can put the robot in the back and scoop out the tonsillar cancer. TORS, it's called. Incredible innovation that I never imagined 5 or 10 years ago. Other specialties are all using. Peter Mac will even do total pelvic exenteration, that big cut operation I told you, of which we've done over 300. Well, we've now started offering select patients a robot approach for that to get them home much faster again. So the two final points I want to speak about is training, because a lot of your focus in your organizations is on training of healthcare professionals, of course. And for us in surgery, that's been a real challenge. And this is a very famous old surgeon from Johns Hopkins Hospital, Halstead, whose name is associated with lots of surgical procedures and descriptions. And it was Halstead who came up with this Halsteadian notion, this apprenticeship notion of how we should learn how to do surgery. All the surgeons in the audience will know this. See one, do one, teach one. That's it. See an operation, do it once, and now you can teach the next fella. And that principle, unfortunately, is the way most of us have learned. And that's how we learned in old theatres. That's at Guy's Hospital where I trained. That's from the 1820s, so before anesthesia, before electricity. That's what surgery used to look like. And this is from the New England Journal of Medicine, which celebrated 200 years of surgery in a nice documentary recently, imagining that sort of scene of what surgery was like in the 1820s. Patient needs to be secured to the operating table. They still do, I must say, especially for robot surgery. Adequately comforted before the surgery, and then the wizened old professor of surgery with all the students and dressers nearby asks for his surgical instrumentation to perform an amputation. Now, surgery in those days had to be quick, of course, because the mortality rate was about 40% with this type of surgery, but the mortality rate of not having the surgery with a gangrenous leg was 100% within 6 weeks, of course. So have we evolved? And I think that's where technology has certainly given us some tools to help with surgical training. And I'll focus particularly on what the robot allows us in five different areas. First, so when people want to come and spend a fellowship year with us, or indeed we've just bought a new Da Vinci system, so the technology is different, we will direct them towards these many online resources. So you can acquire a lot of knowledge about this type of intervention away from the operating theater, which we insist on, actually, and you have to come in with your certification, surgeons or trainees, before you do that. Hands-on training, and this is with our partners, Device Technologies, who are very good at supporting the startup of these systems as they were at RPA. So we don't want people learning on the job with a patient asleep. We insist people spend hours and hours out of the operating room, or at least when the patient's not there, understanding this complex technology. Virtual reality training I've mentioned, and this is a really valuable thing. That's the simulator on the back of the console there. And we insist all our fellows spend 12 hours on the simulator before we will let them anywhere near a patient. Dry lab training is also important. So this is one of our operating theaters in the old building, actually. That's an operating table. But rather than a patient being there, the surgeon's just practicing suturing skills. So he acquires those skills away from the operating environment. And the dual console is the Rolls Royce, of course. And only a few hospitals in this country, yours included, mine included, has invested in this type of technology. And the only reason to do this is to try and make surgery safer for our patients, really for our future patients, because these are surgeons for the future we're training. And that's what you see here. There's a surgeon on one console, Tom, doing dry lab training here in the operating room. He's practicing suturing for the prostatectomy. And on the other console, George, the other surgeon, is on a virtual reality simulator. And we set these sessions up very frequently, 3 hours at a time. They swap over and other people come in. So the paradigm has shifted from what Halstead taught us at Johns Hopkins. Instead of see one, do one, teach one, we will now have technology training ahead of time, online, easy to access, 24 hours a day. We will observe very many procedures. That's what YouTube is for. We will assist in very many procedures, so we understand the nuances of the perioperative environment and see the real surgery happening. We will simulate on the simulator. We'll rehearse in the dry lab. We'll perform the procedure with a senior surgeon ducking in and out all the time, pressing the button, swapping controls back and forth, and only then will we do one. So what a step that is for complex surgery of any type. If you can go through this type of paradigm and avoid the see one, do one, teach one, then that's going to be better for all our patients. Learning curve is a big issue with all complex surgeries, and prostatectomy is really one of them. So we don't want patients, you don't want to be patients, being exposed to someone's learning curve. And that's what I think these types of technologies offer us, is the environment, the platforms to make surgery safer for everybody, reduce learning curves, etc. Finally, I'm going to speak a little bit about the cost. Oh, before I do that, I have to show Kean. This is my now 10-year-old boy starting his robotic surgery training when he was 3 years old back in 2010 when we got one of these machines in. And I literally, you know, he couldn't even reach the pedals, but we stuck his fingers in there straight away, looked in the 3D viewer, and he's moving the rubber bands around on the little device. So that's rather worrying for the older surgeons. Every time we're running a training course, I always show this saying, you know, it might be too late, I'm not sure. You might have missed the boat a little bit. The three-year-old can do it. Take-home messages on this: it's no longer exotic technology for urologists. It's standard kit in the big centers. Significant implications for training, and the robot platform offers incredible training opportunities. But the final few messages I want to talk about is the fact that this is a very disruptive technology. These are very disruptive times. We have to understand that. We've had the whole theme set during the great debate earlier on. These machines are coming into our world, into our healthcare environment. How do we regulate it? How do we control for it, et cetera? How do we grow it? And the robot's a classic example of that. These types of headlines a few years ago were going out everywhere: the robot's fantastic, the robot, and the robot's doing the surgery, not the surgeon. But the backlash is pretty quick, actually, and it's not long before you have a disruptive technology comes in. It might upset referral patterns, it might upset other hospitals, blah, blah, blah. And the headlines come pretty quick, actually. You know, the negative headlines come very fast, and this is from Australia, but these headlines are all around the world. Wall Street Journal: surgical robot examined in injuries. A gynecologist cut both ureters with the robot. Now, the surgeons here know that you don't need to have a robot for the gynecologist to cut both of the ureters. It's perfectly easy to do it without a robot. But this is the big issue, and this is the big challenge, and this is the big barrier, if you like, to the rollout of this technology is expensive. You know, these machines cost between $3 and $4.5 million to buy, so they're up there with sort of linear accelerators, expensive MRI machines. And we're used to spending that in a cancer center on other machines, but surgeons don't really tend to spend a lot of money on stuff. It's pretty cheap, most of the surgery we do. So then to suddenly have a sort of a $3 million tool, or our one, new one, we just ordered, is coming next week, is $4.5 million, it requires some scrutiny. And one of the problems is, and I put this up because I so enjoyed this debate, we need to challenge how we roll out these technologies, how we assess them, what sort of cost-effectiveness research we do, and I really enjoyed the debate. And I'm not just a robotophile, you know, I've challenged this the whole way through. I publish a lot of data about robotic surgery, I publish a lot of criticism about robotic surgery, and this is writing in Nature last year, where I gave some of my views on how we've rolled this out. And within it, I was very critical of the fact that we have a monopoly environment, and this is the big challenge. It's not just the only reason it's expensive, it is expensive, but we have a monopoly robot supplier in the market all around the world. To address this, in Melbourne, we were given a $500,000 grant to evaluate robotic surgery in the public health system, and it was an MD project from Marnie Basto, one of our fantastic young trainees, which led to a number of publications. I'm only going to show you one graph from this key paper, and essentially what this showed is that if you compare robotic surgery in the public system in Melbourne with open surgery, and we did that over a three-year period, 5,000 cases, robotic surgery is more expensive in the public system until you get to a high volume. So we showed that patients go home the next day, that saves money. We showed that there are much less blood transfusions, almost none, that saves money, and positive margins are less. But does that offset the expensive cost of the robot? It does if you do over 140 cases per year, and that's the key number. You need to do high-volume surgery, high-quality surgery, and if you do, then you're cost-effective. And these machines, therefore, should only be in high-volume centers. And it also allows other procedures to benefit. And, of course, we got some nice headlines for this as well. There have been some negative headlines, and this is a randomized study, of course, high level of evidence, randomized study from Brisbane, open surgery versus robotic surgery, showing no difference. And I blogged about this in the BJUI, at which I'm an editor, and I think this is one of the most important headlines about everything we do in innovation and in technology. It's not about the machine, is it? It's going to be about the humans driving machines or the environments we work in, and I think that's very important that we remember. If you take an inadequately trained, inexperienced surgeon and put them on a $4 million robot, that doesn't turn them into an extremely experienced, dedicated surgeon. And there's a challenge about this, because here's a lovely piece in the BJUI, which reflects everything about surgical research. It says, why don't Mercedes-Benz publish randomized trials? So a new E-class comes out, it's lighter than the last one, more fuel efficient, more green, bigger, longer. Is it any better than the old Mercedes-Benz? Why are you going to buy the new one? Is there a randomized trial that shows the new one's better than the old one? There isn't. And industry has a different way of assessing quality, and it's called statistical process control. So they have incremental improvements all the time in what they do, and they can measure that. There's a lot of graphs that come out about this. It's all written about in this paper. And we think in surgery, actually, because of surgeon heterogeneity, other factors that disrupt randomized trials, we should be looking at ongoing statistical process control, incremental improvements, cost-effectiveness research, quality of life research to measure success, and probably randomized control trials, as they've shown over the years, are not the way to measure surgical excellence. Finally, more robots are coming. You'll be pleased to hear if you're on the losing side of the debate this afternoon. Here are some of them. The Da Vinci company have a very nice machine, which is a single-port robot. So this is very dramatic. This is only 12 millimeters in diameter, a single port that you would put in at the belly button or into the chest or wherever you want to put it. And then you can deploy down the telescope there with the two eyes, so it's a 3D telescope and other instruments. It's all wristed, so the telescope can look around the abdomen or the chest or wherever you are, and then bang, all the wrists are multi-wristed as well. So normally for minimally invasive surgery, you have to spread things out so you can get a bit of room. But with these new technologies, single port, etc., we'll be able to do things through very, very tiny holes, which will be very exciting. And the final slide I want to talk about is Verb Surgical. So Verb Surgical is probably the big competitor on the horizon that we're looking forward to. It's the thing that's going to embrace technology and data, machine learning, the things we've spoken about today. It is a joint venture between Google and J&J, who are an enormous surgical instrument company. So you take a giant surgical company and the giant data company. They've combined forces. They're extremely well-funded. And they say they're going to create a different surgical environment for us and our patients in the future. An environment where the data about the patient, the scans, the genetic risk factors, etc., will be in the surgical environment and the decision-making for those patients. And my final thoughts, as we think about this machine-human interface that we've been speaking about, I don't think we should resist it. I think we have to embrace it, and we have to also understand that the progress we will make by interfacing with machines, machine learning, technologies, etc., will be offset in terms of maybe employment loss by gains for our patients and new employment opportunities, as has been shown for centuries and centuries as new technologies come in. And I congratulate you here in this symposium for putting together really some of the best human capital we have working in the health sector in Australia. And this symposium today is just a fantastic privilege to speak at. I thank you again for the invitation.